First designed in 1920, first raced on in 1921, and first used for Grand Prix racing in 1925. Circuit de Spa-Francorchamps originally linked these towns of Spa, Malmedy, and Stavelot, and over the years has evolved into the mecca of motorsports that we know today. Today, the iRacing Grand Prix World Championship drivers will do 44 grueling, tough laps around one of the most beautiful, picturesque, and difficult circuits on the iRacing calendar, as they try to battle for that championship. This is one track that Gregor Hutu has never won at, and at the start of the last broadcast we said that Hugo Lewis had to start winning races, and he had to start winning them fast. That's exactly what he did at Silverstone, and by scoring pole position here today at Spa, he is now looking to make it back-to-back victories and start closing that gap to the team redline driver of Gregor Hutu. Atzi Kirchhoff and Luke McLean are once again strong in qualifying, with McLean ahead of his teammate Kirchhoff. So as we saw at Silverstone, there's going to be three redline cars trying to do everything in their power to get themselves to the top step of the podium. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to iRacing Super Saturday on Glacier TV for the 10th round of the iRacing.com World Championship Grand Prix Series. Will Benson, along with Marius Gollenbeck and Rob Cuss. Marius, first of all, welcome back to the Glacier TV booth after a bit of an absence. And secondly, we all of a sudden have a championship battle on our hands, because you've seen it at the last round. Luis back in the game, winning at Silverstone, and now he's looking to try and take victory at Spa.
Thanks, Will. Great to be back, guys, here at the historic Spa-Francorchamps circuit. Second time this season we go here. And yes, you said it, championship battle is on. However, Hugo is still around 100 points behind Gregor Hutu here, but you said it, Gregor's never won at Spa-Francorchamps, and with the pole position for Hugo, it looks good that this stage is where at least he's trying to keep it this way. But as we know, Gregor Hutu is trying to extend his championship, and by just making it second again, he's not exactly losing too much, but definitely wants to get a win today.
We'll run through the full championship standings in just a moment, but your top five: Gregor Hutu, 410 points. Hugo Lewis, 311 points. Atzi Kirchhoff, 289 points. Jake Sturgis in fourth, 199. Martin Conquet rounds out the top five. He's got 172 points, but don't forget, he will no longer be racing until the last round of the season at Montreal. Let's have a look at a bit of a look at this close track play cool circuit Spa Francorchamps. This is a Glacier TV track guide. Circuit de Spa-Francorchamps, set in the Ardennes region of Belgium, is known as one of the most challenging racetracks in the world, mainly due to the fact it's fast, hilly, twisty, and weather is always so unpredictable. It was first designed in 1920 as a 15-kilometer racetrack, which ran through the Belgian towns of Spa, Malmedy, and Stavelot. Those corner names exist today in the 4.352 mile 20 corner racetrack. Well, the track record is held by Sebastian Vettel, set in 2009 with a time of 1:47.263. Of course, the racetrack holds Formula One events, but also GT racing as well. And the track is so diverse, there's so many stories that you can always think about, and it really is a true driver's track. I'm going to take you through the racetrack now. Exiting the bus stop, you see this is the main start finish line. You'll see it's very, very narrow here as you break from one of the slowest corners in all of Formula One, turn number one, last source. You approach it at about 180 miles an hour in Formula One cars, slow in GT cars, but only 30 miles an hour on the apex. You've got to get a good run out of here, however, for the endurance start finish rate that you're coming through now, but then Air Rouge, left-hand flick, perhaps the most famous corner in all of road racing. Then you flick it to the right as you enter now Radio, the left-hand kink as well. You've got to get yourself a good run through here. Don't use too much of the curbs because that car will want to spear off the racetrack into those tyre barriers. Then you're onto the Kenwell straightaway, which does have that little kink before it straightens itself out as you set yourself up now for that run down to Lacombe. You'll hit your fastest part of the racetrack before you brake. You brake as late as you possibly can. hand, you'll see the rumble strips on the left hand side, and then you book that car to the right hand side for the first part of the coombe, then to the left. Use quite a lot of curb here as you settle the car down for that final right hander to come out of the low coombe complex. Get yourself a good run out of here as you now go downhill into turns 8 and 9. Rivage, you want to brake later than you actually think you can. Lots of grip as you're on your way here. Hold the inside line as you come out, and then you do that left hand flick, and this is where the track really starts to get fast. Now you're approaching the full-on section of the racetrack, a double apex left hander, which really does test the driver's mental and physical stamina. So many G's coming through the first part of this corner. You'll shift down a couple of gears, but then you'll be flat out all the way through turn number 11, the second part of full-on. A lot of an escape road on the outside of the racetrack, which normally is forbidden by race control, as you can all come down into the final chicane, turns number 12 and 13. The first part is all about setting yourself up for the second part of the corner, where again, you've got to get yourself a good exit as you work yourself down into Stabilo. Another double apex right-hander. The first part, get yourself a good run on the curbs, and then try and use as much of the throttle as you can as you run it all the way over the curbs on the exit of turn number 15. Now you're working yourself down the back straight away. You've got yourselves a couple of kinks here as you're working yourself down into Blanchimont. This is where Luciano Berti had his accident in 2001, which put paid to his Formula 1 career. A huge crash he had there. You're going to be flat out in some cars, just dabbing off the throttle a little bit in others as you come down now to the bus stop chicane, the second slowest corner on the racetrack. You've got to get good momentum here. Passing is possible, but you're really going to have to set that car up all the way down the back straight to get the job done. Come out, it's very slippery on the way out. You'll see a lot of drivers getting loose on the power, work it down the start finish line, and that is a lap of one of the toughest racetracks in the world, Circuit de Spa-Francorchamps.
So welcome back to the Glacier TV pre-race show for the 10th round of the iRacing.com World Championship Grand Prix Series for the little thing that we like to call iRacing Super Saturday. Already, we've had the first episode of the F1 show. If you missed it, where the hell were you? You can find that on our YouTube channel in about an hour's time. We also today have a special episode of IndyCar Weekly coming your way at 5 p.m. GMT, and then the inaugural iRacing Pocono 400 will be taking place from 6 p.m. GMT. Live commentary as well as broadcast and everything else will be available on YouTube for that race as well. Marius, let's turn our attention to the championship standings, and Gregor Hutu still has that championship lead. However, he lost 15 points in that last round because he could only come home in the third position.
Yeah, but then again, you said it, he's still got a huge gap to Hugo Lewis. At the moment, that's 99 points in front of the Brazilian, and we're already in round 10 of 16, so he's not exactly got much time, Hugo Lewis, for getting points off Gregor here, so he definitely needs to chunk off a huge bit today, at least today, and definitely in the next couple of events as well. But 99 points, you get 50 for the win, you get 40 for the second place. So Gregor could still afford to just come second in every race from now on. And Hugo could basically win every race and he would still win the championship. So that's how clear it appears. But one drop down result, one definite DNF, and maybe just a crash can always happen. And you're facing yourself with 50 points less than your opponent. And then it's getting a bit more tricky. We've still got 7 races to go, including the one today. And you may not underestimate how quickly it can actually change. But as for now, Hugo Lewis has rather taken a look back on the grid, because Latsi Kirkhope is also just 22 points behind him, rather than looking in the front to Gregor Hutu, who's almost 100 points ahead.
And also, let's not forget that Hutu's worst finish of the season, he equaled that last time out at Silverstone. So Hutu, even if he does crash the way the drop tweaks works, he can afford to have one big incident and get away with that. Luis had a terrible middle part of the season, losing a lot of those points in the championship. Kirkhoff is still kind of in the battle for second position. Jake Sturgis not quite out of it either. He sat in fourth position. Then, as I say, Martin Kroncate is in fifth. Stephen Michaels now up to sixth position in the championship standings, tied in points with Marta Petilla. Fulvio Barrazzini is sat in 8th, Max Bologo in 9th, and then Yuda Narumi rounds out the top 10. We'll talk about qualifying in just a moment, but before that, I'd like to welcome into the Glacier TV booth, Dom Doohan. Dom, as team principal for Team Redline, we're now into that second half of the season. It's getting to the tight end now. Are you worried in any way, shape, or form about the resurgence of Hugo Lloris?
Well, one thing that we know about Hugo is that he's a fighter, and at the end of the season, he's always stronger. So, yeah, always a concern that he could catch and overtake Gregor, but, you know, he's had a bit of bad luck, and Gregor's no easy person to beat as well, so who knows?
And we talked to you before in Ice Lounge about, you know, the dynamic within Team Redline. It seems to be the last couple of races, Luke McLean, Anthony Kirchhoff, Gregor Huta, they have all been working very well together. And you saw it in qualifying once again, second, third and fourth position on the grid. You've got to be happy as that as team boss.
Absolutely. But, you know, it is essentially, it's Hugo's the main competitor at the moment. So, you know, if Gregor wants to win the championship or if Atsy wants to get second in the championship, you've got to beat Hugo. And he's a tough competitor.
And Huta has never actually won at this racetrack. How much would a win mean to him today on perhaps one of the most beautiful and demanding circuits on the F1 calendar?
You're right. And do you know what? Gregor's won in every other simulation. It's just in DWC. He hasn't had either that luck or that success. And I just think he wants to put this one to bed and get the win.
Well, good luck in the race. I'm sure you'll stick around for a little bit of it. Dom Duhan there, the team principal for Team Redline. Maris, we've alluded to qualifying just a little bit. What a great lap by Hugo Lloris. Over a tenth of a second faster than Gregor Huta. He didn't actually need to do his second timed lap because Huta messed up as he was working himself through the fungus chicane in Stavelo and wasn't able to complete that lap. But Lloris still went faster, half a tenth faster than he did on his first timed lap. What really is one of his best qualifying for the entire season.
Yeah, probably. And just getting a 10th out on a 1 minute 47 lap doesn't particularly seem like much. But if we take a look down the grid, you see that the pole lap of Hugo Lloris is just about 2 seconds quicker than including the whole of the grid. So even Wes Richards, all the way down in 33rd, is only running the only 1 minute 49 in the grid. And it's less than 1 second for the entire top 20. So if you take a look, even Pablo Lopez, Timo Ivan, and Jason Lovett, the guys just outside of the top 20, just outside the 1 minute 47s, they are still just shy of 1 second short of Hugo Lloris. So you see how close the grid actually is. And even if you take a look, just 3 tenths down where Fulvio Barrosini, Andrea Bertrand are, there's so close gaps between these cars, and we're almost talking at a 2 minute lap here. And if you lose a 10th on that lap, you could easily drop down 5 positions. But then again, that's something not really new to us. You guys just talked about it. It's just about avoiding mistakes, really. You can afford to do a semi-decent lap here, but you cannot afford to do any mistake on your qualifying lap, as well as on the race, of course. Because one mistake, especially in this Formula 1 car, will cost you 2, 3, 4 tenths so easily that you find yourself a whole set of positions further down.
So confirmation then, Hugo Lloris, pole position, second race in a row, a time of 1 minute 47.215. Gregor Huta, second position, 1:47.330. Luke McLean in third, Atsy Kirchhoff in fourth, and Martin Fitzgerald rounds out the top five. Fulvio Barrosini scores a sixth place starting position here. Andre Borcher in seventh, Stephen Michaels in eighth, Yuna Narumi in ninth, and Iker Hapala rounds out the top 10. Then you've got Max Lorco in the 11th position and Ricardo Castro Adio, the only pro driver by my looking who's got into this race. You did have Yuru Abe also try to qualify. He just missed the cut here today, which will be a shame because he had a great race the last time we were out here at Silverstone. In fact, was our combined driver of the race. Towards the rear of the field, two drivers didn't qualify. That was Alexia Loma and Ruku Alataulo. And total 33 cars setting a qualifying time. Wes Richards, of course, was the slowest one of them. He's dramatically off the pace, half a second slower actually than the last other qualifier, which is Andrew Sakom in the number 19 car. But let's talk about the race itself. It's 44 laps here today, Marius, and strategy can play a big part here at Spa. We expect everyone generally to go down the same route, however.
Yeah, but then again, you say it. people like Max Zalorka, we've talked about that in the pre-race show, they always kind of go for extreme situation strategies. So Max today not really put the qualifying together, and not in the first couple of spots, in fact in 11th. So that again calls for an outstanding strategy to make up a lot of positions here. And we've seen during the season that it can actually work. Max has had a great strategy at Sebring, giving him a few dozens of positions, in fact. So it can work, definitely. But you said it, the general strategy consensus is not too far off. So we're thinking that everyone's roughly on the same strategy. But then again, one lap difference on your first pit stop, if everyone's close together, can already make the change of losing or gaining a position.
Of course, we are at the most famous racetrack in all of road racing, Circuit Spa-Francorchamps, for 44 laps here today. Don't forget, you can go over to Team Redline for World Championship tipping. Great thing. You can pick out your best drivers who you think is going to score first, second and third place in each race. Let's give out a shout to our friends over at ETV as well. And also, of course, iRacing.com, the world's premier motorsport simulator. Get yourself half price off your first 3 months membership by heading over to iRacing.com right now. We have got ourselves about a minute before we head ourselves down to the grid, Marius. Who is going to win today?
You always ask the same questions, but I never find an easy answer towards this. I mean, sure, Greg has never had a win on this, but you definitely can't take him out of contention today. But I think showing that the qualifying pace by Hugo is just so good today, I think he might just have the little edge he needs to beat Gregor and, of course, Luke, Atsy and all the guys behind them. So my money's on Hugo, and face it, he needs to win this one. He cannot afford to come second or third, because if he wants to have a shot at the championship, he needs to get the 50 points.
Dom, one of your boys going to win it? Who do you think?
I think it's going to be mega tight. Four guys going for it, and it's going to be done on pits.
Me personally, I'm going to go with Kirchhoff. I know he loves this track. I know he's very good at this track. Although he's starting on the outside of row number two, I think that he's got a great chance of bringing that car to the top step of the winner's rostrum here today. Don't count out Luke McLean either. He is incredibly good at this racetrack. Checker flag is out for the end of practice. We're heading ourselves down to the race grid for 44 laps for the 10th round of the iRacing.com World Championship Grand Prix Series. Don't forget, head over to isowc.org/live. That's isowc.org/live for live timing and scoring throughout the race. And also, after this race, we'll have a little bit of IndyCar Weekly and also the iRacing.com Pocono 400 as well. We'd like to call this iRacing Super Saturday because it really is two of the most demanding races in all of iRacing this year. And the first one is going to get underway very, very soon. 44 laps around Spa. Can Hugo Lloris take victory and make it back-to-back victories in the World Championship Series? Can Hutu get back to the top step of the podium? Can Luke McLean or Atsy Kirchhoff win their first race of the year and finally end that stranglehold for those top two drivers? We're going to find out at some point over the next hour and a half. We're waiting for those lights to go on and go off the iRacing.com gantry. Lights out and away we go for the 10th round of the series. And it looks as though we have a slow car in the rear of the field, but in the battle for the race lead, Hugo Lloris has got himself the start he needed. Hutu is in second position. We have a crash as well. I see two cars involved at least in that. That was at the source. We'll get confirmation of who that is at the moment, because these cars are storming down into the aerodrome complex. And look at how close Gregor Hutu is. Is he going to try and go around the outside into the comp for the first time? This will be his best chance to do it. He's on the outside. Who will be the last of the late breakers? Will it be Hutu? Will it be Lloris? And Hutu is to the race lead.
Yeah, brilliant move by Gregor Hutu, making it round the outside into Le Comte, of course. It is possible to do that, but you've seen it just by the late braking, he's already getting the advantage. Andrea Berger moves up into fifth position. Atsy Kirchhoff, in fact, down into fourth. And he's had a little bit of contact between him and Fulvio Barrosini outside of Le Source. And it looks like no damage for either one of them, but Fulvio Barrosini dropped a position by that.
Yudan Arumi was one of the cars involved in that incident down at La Source. It was him And I also believe it was Steven Michaels there in the Twister Racing car. Both of them have damage. It looks as though everyone else was able to get through last horse without issue. A number of drivers having to use that runoff area. In fact, they were three wide at the rear of the field as they headed it down into Air Rouge. But Hutu now leads the way as they're going to work themselves onto the back straightaway through Gauchemont for the first time. Hugo Lloris is scored in the second position right now. Luke McLean is in third, but already has dropped off the rear. And actually Kirchhoff in that fourth position even further back. So Kirchhoff and McLean need to hope they have got a bit more fuel. But McLean's actually closed that gap just a tiny bit behind them. They are really kind of in a big train. You've got a crash. Timo Riitonen looks like he's going to be out of the race. He's trying to make a late move on Paul Ilbrink, and Ilbrink got squirty, and that put Evenin into the side of him, and it looks as though that Evenin might be out of the race, Marius.
Yeah, and Battle's back on the focus on Hugo Lloris and Gregor Hutu. Hutu took the lead in the first lap, and now the same situation could brew up as Hugo Lloris has got the slipstream now onto Gregor Hutu, and we know the cars gain or generate a lot of slipstream here, so Hugo Lloris will be close once again for Lecom. Not as close as Gregor Hutu, though, and you see it's getting a little bit less than slipstream now, but he could do an attack around the outside, just as Gregor Hutu did last lap, but not enough. He's not close enough. Gregor's just going late on the brakes and defending the first position.
We had a big crash at the end of lap number one down at the Boss Top Chicane. This involved Paul Ilbrink, Daniel Lopez, Ricardo Castro Yido, and also Jeremy Boutelip might have got a little bit of contact there as well. I saw one of the other Inex cars having to work around the long way. That was Jason Lover. Meanwhile, we'll turn our attention back to that battle out front. Luis, it does look as though he can stick with Hutu for the time being. Hutu had to make that run at the very start. He got it on the outside. We've seen that in the Pro Series as well. It's Filo who took that position on the outside before. But Luis needs to make sure he can keep within about a second right now of Gregor Hutu for these first couple of laps and hope that Hutu doesn't pull away. Luke McLean is closing up in that third position right now. He has scored just half a second behind Luis in that battle for second position. Kirchhoff's in four, and Borcher rounds out the top five. And you have to start hoping, Marius, that Borcher puts a bit of pressure on Kirchhoff and perhaps on McLean as well to kind of ease things out for Luis a little bit so he can look forward rather than look in his rearview mirror.
Yeah, and I've had a talk with Andre just before the race. He said he's not particularly put up much practice here, but he's always liked Spa and he's always had a strong pace here, and he found himself only slightly slower than Hugo in practice, so that can only be a good sign here. And he said it, he gained two positions from his grip position, moved up from 7th into 5th, and is now starting to put on pressure on the team redline pack, in fact consisting out of Atsi Kirchhoff and Luke McLean.
Max DeLorco started this race in the 11th position, now working himself in the 6th position on the racetrack. Another good start by him. Barrazzini's lost one position earlier on in that Triple M car. He's right now scored behind Max DeLorco, but gets himself a very good run through Air Rouge as they work themselves down the Camel Treadway once again, down into Lacombe. He's going to look his car down to the inside. The battle for 6th position right now. Barrazzini, will he get the job done? No, he won't. Looks like Barrazzini right there actually just doesn't have the same straight line speed as Max Dell.
And if you've just seen on the cameras, the battle for the lead is still ongoing, and it just looks like Lecom is the only possible position you can make a move here. You've always seen Hugo Lewis being close for the bus stop chicane, but never really close enough to try an outbreak. Gregor Hutu here, he's now lost a bit of space to him, in fact, by trying to make it around the outside again, so he definitely needs to work for the rest of the lap to get the draft back, because, as we know, once it's lost, it's going to be a whole lot harder than it is now.
Miguel Martin had to bring his car onto pit road at the conclusion of lap number one for a jump start. And Martin actually started this race down in the 26th position. However, right now he's scored in the 24th position due to incidents that involved some drivers behind him on the racetrack. He was in fact able to get through that carnage that was going on at the bus stop chicane as he just bruises past Simon Cattell, set up another position there for him. But Cattell's actually very struggling. Meanwhile, Iker Hakkinen, we're going to turn our attention over to him, involved in a battle right now with Mogar Filho as they work themselves down towards the bus stop chicane once again. Hakkinen's going to go to the outside line. Would it be able to be the last of the late breakers? Yes, he will. But then you see there that Filho's going to hold that inside line. Hakkinen will just be able to squeeze him. He needs to try and get clear. He doesn't, however. This will give Filho the inside line as they come down into La Source once again. We'll turn our attention over to Pablo Lopez, because that is actually Pablo Lopez on the inside line. And Lopez is able to complete the pass. And also, Hapada now is being passed at the same time by Christian Laurent. So Laurent's off the position, and then Hapada from being able to get past Lopez falls down two positions on the racetrack, Mario.
Yeah, very interesting battle there. You've seen that Ilka fought against Pablo approaching the bus stop chicane, as Ilka is now trying to get the position back with a lot of slipstream help from Pablo Lopez here. But they've been side by side for the entire bus stop chicane. They've been side by side for start finish. And you see Ilka Apala once again side by side right now against Christian Llorente. And he might have the edge right now. And it looks like he's going to make it into Rivage right now. Inside being right there is a huge advantage. But Christian Llorente with a bold move around the outside. And that is an absolutely astonishing move from the driver of the number 40 F1 car here. He's making the pass just by swerving into the turn a bit and then getting the car done and out ahead of Ilka Apala for the left-hander. So a very bold move, but you see it work. And look at how far they are away from Pablo Lopez right now.
And they lost a lot of time there going side by side over the course of that first part of that. Great driving there by the number 40 car of Christian Llorente, as he's been able to keep ahead of Ilka Apala for the time being to run through your top 10. Gregor Hutu now has about a half a second lead over Hugo Lloris, but Lloris is still pushing, still trying to close that gap to the red line driver out front. Luke McLean in the third position. He's now fallen back to 8 tenths of a second behind Lloris. In fourth is Atte Kirkhoff. Fifth, Andre Borcher, who in fact was very close there to the rear of Jake Sturgios. It looks as though that Borcher's got some rear wing damage. We're trying to figure out what's happened to him, but he's fallen right down the pack. Now scored in the seventh position on the racetrack. He tried to make a move on Jake Sturgios. This is a battle for sixth position on the racetrack. And all of a sudden, Borcher is fallen back.
Yeah, and I wonder what rear wing damage could mean. In fact, it can only mean one thing, that he got rear-ended. And by the looks of it, all happened one lap ago as Max Dall'Orco is rear-ending Andrea Borcher in turn one as he's lost it sideways into turn one, and back on the focus is he right now. No straight line speed with a bent wing, and both Fulvio Berezzini and Jake Sturgis go past, and Berezzini with a bold line there getting a lot of slip there, and Andrea Borcher goes straight back past as the mistake from Fulvio Berezzini comes into play. But you just see the car is absolutely not competitive anymore with the rear wing damage. A lot of oversteer for the German Mi3D driver here, and he's got to do the off track right then, almost losing the car. And you see it's absolutely difficult to drive right now, and I wouldn't be surprised if he needs to go to the pits and let that damage be repaired.
And Berezzini able to get past there on the way down into Pua, was able to get that pass done on Andre Borcher. But great three-wide racing down into La Coombe between Jake Sturgios, Fulvio Berezzini and Borcher. And Jake Sturgios is able to get himself now up into the sixth position on the racetrack. Berezzini now up into the seventh position as well. Max Lorco is falling off the pace of Atte Kirkhoff and Luke McLean. In fact, those two team redline drivers are pretty much running nose to tail at the moment, Marius. But they've fallen now back to about 1.5 seconds behind Lloris. They've lost that draft. It is once again just Hutu and Lloris in that battle up front.
Yeah, and you see, losing the draft is really just costing you a whole lot. I mean, the car doesn't behave much different, but the lap times are just going to be so much slower. This time by Gregor Hutu, 50.2, Hugo Lewis, 50.0, and both Luke McLean and Atte Kirkhoff around the 0.5 mark, and they are still around 3 tenths quicker than all the guys ahead who've got no slipstream at all. So it's definitely a big effect with tracks like this, long straights here, and Andrea Borcher is tossed down into 8th position, in fact, and the best example for him right now, a bent rear wing is going to cost you a whole lot of rear downforce and as well as straight line speed. So Marty Pietola gets the slipstream of him now, and even though Andrea Borcher has slipstream off the car ahead, Pietola is still gaining on it.
Retirees out of this race: David Corpse, Jason Lovat, Yudai Narumi, Simon Cattell, Paul Ilbring, Enzo Benito and Ben Cornett. Cornett will be scored in the 35th and final position, so difficult day once again for the Aussie. In fact, he's actually one of the most popular drivers, however, still in the iRacing World Championship Grand Prix Series. There was a vote for the All-Star race, and Cornett absolutely owned that one, having a difficult season, however, for the time being. And Hutu, even though we're only working on lap number 6, already coming through some traffic. Simon Cattell, I think he said he put his car to stop there at the Fungi Chicane. His car just isn't working for him at all. But that battle up front is now down to 4 tenths of a second. And you have to say, Lloris, he might be on a bit of a longer strategy, because he doesn't look as though he has the straight line speed of Gregor Hutu, but he's still able to hassle that car around the corners, Marius.
Yeah, and it's really just important to maintain the draft. You said it. If he's not got the straight line speed, he definitely needs the draft to get back at Gregor Hutu, and then he's always going to lose a little bit in the turns, but as soon as you go back on a straight, he will have the slipstream, and he's just going to crawl himself back up into the spot right behind the rear wing of the Finnish driver from Team Redline here. So second still Hugo Lewis, first still Gregor Hutu, and they've extended the gap to just over 2.5 seconds. Luke McLean and Atsi Kirchhoff in third and fourth, so it's looking like a really good day for Team Redline here. Andre Böttcher has been fifth. He's had a good start here, moved up two positions, but he's got a little bit of rear wing damage from an incident with Max Del Orco, and he's soon going to be overtaken by not just Marty Pietilä, but as well as Moga Filho. And I believe for Andre here, we're only lap seven, and we've got 44 laps in this race. He's going to have a trouble for a race.
And Petita there getting squeezed all the way down to the inside on that run down the Camel straightaway. That might get a word from the iRacing first steward. Petita there was trying to make that pass. She had a good run as they came out of Radeon, but however, wasn't able to get anything done. And now what that's done is it's allowed Mogar Filho to try and put that car down into the inside as they work themselves into Rivage. This is the battle for 8th, 9th, and 10th positions on the racetrack. Filho looking strong here. Of course, he was strong when they raced here in the Pro Series. A good run as they work themselves down into Pouin. Once again, if you can get a good run through here, you can try and perhaps set up a pass down into the Fungus chain. He uses a lot of that curve on the inside, however. That upsets the car just a little bit, so he won't be quite close enough. In fact, it gets on the brakes a little bit earlier to get a good run through the Fungus chain itself. But Filho having a good race. But Petita there, that was very, very close with himself and Borcher.
Yeah, but there's not really been sufficient gap, and I understand that Andre is not going to leave him the inside line there, and he's pretty much leaving himself all the way defenseless for the next turn then. And if you try it where there's no gap, you're always going to end up needing to brake and just back off, as Moga Filho goes past Marty Pietilä as well. And I wonder if Pietilä got a little bit of front wing damage. Yes, it looks like it. Front wing slightly bent, and that just shows how quickly it can go. Little tap from Del Orco, and he's in the pit, so he's definitely seeing this as a bit more damage than Andre Böttcher has to his rear wing. But just take a look at how quick it can go, actually. Del Orco just tapping the rear of Andre Böttcher, rear wing damage. Marty Pietilä just tapping the rear of Andrea Böttcher, front wing damage. So you have to avoid all kinds of damage to be competitive here. And you can even see it now, early pit stop for Marty Pietilä, and that might still work for a two-stop strategy, even with the damage repair.
So, Pietilä is on pit road. He's going to perhaps try and make this into a one-stop race. We are, however, looking at the battle for third position in the race. I'm not really going to call it a battle. They are running line astern for the time being. Luke McLean in the number 24 red line car with his teammate Atsi Kirchhoff in the number 5 red line car right behind him. Of course, Kirchhoff needs the points right now. He wants to keep in touching distance of Hugo Lewis in case he has a bad result later on in the season. Kirchhoff has currently scored third in the championship. He's got Jake Sturgios in fourth behind him, but there's a big points difference between those two drivers for the time being. So Kirchhoff just needs to keep on turning laps and get past the team. That'll be good for his charge, running himself right now in that fourth position. I have to say, though, if we have a look through the gains and losses in this race, Pablo Lopez up 10 positions since the start of this race. Jake Sturgios up 8 positions. Max Lorco up 6 positions. So a good start to the race there for Pablo Paycheck Lopez. Jeremy Busluk up 17 positions. Ricky Anatalo up 20 positions, Marius. Anatalo from 35th to 15th, and we're only 8 laps into this race.
Yeah, and making up positions is just critical to do in the first couple of laps, but it's because as soon as the race gets underway, you're going to find it harder and harder to gain positions here. Max Del Orco as well in fifth right now. We've spoken about the extraordinary strategies Del Orco used in the past, and he's gone from 11th into fifth. And just imagine if he's got a special strategy out here in terms of pace, he's right with the top four runners as well as Jake Sturgis. So if he's on a one or two lap longer pace and he can maintain the 2 seconds to the guys ahead, he might even be in for gaining a further position here.
Going to chuck it down to pit road. Rob Castle looks like Simon Cattell's made an early pit stop as well. And we have just lobster off from time being. some could tell, has made a quick pit stop. It was just a little splash and dash for him. So it looks like he might be on a two-stop strategy now in this race as well. The field has started to spread itself out quite a little bit. You've still got Mogar Filho involved in the battle with Borcher. And you're going to have to say that Filho, if he can get up to the rear of Borcher, will clearly be able to make a pass, because Filho is so much better in the straight line ever since Borcher got himself that rear wing damage early on into that race. Having a look through the field, Petri Cotavara right now in the number 17 Azura racing car, trying to close up to the rear of Christian Laurent. I'm having a look at their previous lap times. It's 1 minute 50.150 for Petri Cotavara. His fastest lap of the race, Christian Laurent, a 1:50.661. Cotavara right now is actually on the move, Marius.
Yeah, he is, and he also came from further down the grid, so you see, qualifying position definitely comes into play. You cannot ever say that it's not important, but he came from 25th all the way up into 14th, and making up more than 10 positions is just, I mean, it's not going to only do with a good start right here. You're also going to need a couple of banging laps right at the beginning, and he's even still down 21 seconds to the lead, so you see how far the lead has already stretched out, and we're only in lap 9 of 44 here, but definitely yeah, good way up into the top 10 for Petri Cotavara. Still possible as Pablo Lopez, who's closing the top 10 right now, only 4 seconds ahead.
And Luis has started to lose that draft just a little bit, actually, to Gregor Hutu in that battle for the race lead. As they came past the stripe last time, it was 0.9 of a second between those two drivers. So it looks as though that slowly Gregor Hutu is able to pull away. Of course, we have a feeling that Hutu might be on a little bit heavier fuel compared to those drivers behind him. Meanwhile, it looks as though that Mogar Filho right now is going to get himself past Borcher. So we knew it's just a matter of time. Filho moves himself now up into the 8th position on the racetrack. A good drive right now from that number 27 Radical car as he works himself down into Rivage once again. Marius, who do you think? Do you think that Luis actually is on heavier fuel than Hutu? Or is Hutu just being able to charge away right now?
It's definitely hard to say, especially now that Hugo's just lost the draft. He's on a similar pace. He's just done almost the same lap time, 0.705 and a 0.711. So the difference between these two guys is just as low as ever. So I don't see how any one of them is on a different fuel stop strategy, but it can always be that one driver's heavier than the other, but I'm not seeing how it's further different than one lap.
Working ourselves right now on lap number 10 of 44 in the 10th round of the Irish.com World Championship Grand Prix Series here from Circuit de Spa-Francorchamps. Will Vinson, Rob Cuss, Marius Gonenbeck in the booth for the entire portion of this race. Your race leader, Gregor Hutu, he's able to get that jump on Hugo Lloris on the run down into Lacombe and has led every lap since then. Hugo Lloris starting to close that gap once again. It is now down to just 0.8 of a second on the racetrack. Last time by, Hugo Lloris did a 1:49.587. Wasn't actually his fastest lap of the race. Yes, it was his fastest lap of the race. Gregor Hutu, he did a 1:49.729 last time by, just 0.02 of a second slower than his fastest lap of the race. Andre Borch will give you an update on him, Marius. He really is struggling. And of course, this track is a big tyre eater. You can really overheat the tyres here. And I think from Borcher, that rear wing damage is just taking its toll with every single lap. I think he's going to try and make it into a two-stop race, but he's got to get to that window before he can do that.
Yeah, and I don't want to be in his seat right now, because that's just a terrible thing that can happen. I remember when I was driving the Pro Series myself, I found myself just slightly bent front axle after the first lap chaos we had in the Pro Series. And you don't feel like there's much wrong with the car, but you just see you cannot get to your lap times. You're 1.5, 2 seconds off, and Andre's just done a 1:52. And at that rate, people behind him are catching him by 1.5 second a lap. And you just know you can't get quicker than this, and you know you will be caught. And we've seen it one lap to go. He's just let Mogar Filho pass, and he's already gone all the way into the distance. So this race will definitely feel a lot longer than 44 laps for Andre Böttcher, as we're just 25% into this race. And yeah, if anything, I mean, he's definitely going to drop out of the top 10 for now, and he can just hope for a damage repair on the pit stop.
And Andre and Icarpano even need to get himself past Pablo Lopez. So Lopez once again outside of the top 10. Meanwhile, Ati Kirchhoff in the number 5 car, very close to the rear of Luke McLean right now. And it does look as though that Kirchhoff actually wants to try and find a way past his teammate I think Kirkhoff thinks that he can be faster than if he was sat behind Luke McLean right now.
Yeah, and it looks like his front wing is a little bit damaged, but I wonder if that's still from the collision in the first lap with Fulvio Barrazzini, so not sure if any damage got added to that, but you said it. Definitely a good fight between teammates, and you can't argue for any team order here, because they are fighting just like they would know each other, or even hate each other, but don't want to say that. Definitely a good fight between the Team Redline drivers here for the third position, and I don't think any one of them would give up in a fight. So Max Del Orco in fifth, he definitely likes seeing that, I'm sure.
And in fact, we'll bring Dom Duhan into this conversation.
Max Del Orco's out. Sorry for that, Will. Max Del Orco is in fact out and has had a terrible incident and going all the way down into Eau Rouge. It looks like he's just lost the steering input and his car went completely straight and even flipped over Fulvio Barrazzini. Looks like Barrazzini's got no damage at all, but terrible incident for Del Orco.
Delco is out of the race. In fact, his car flipped over the catch fence and onto the endurance pit road as well. And he did literally just lose steering. I'm wondering if he caught a curb wrong or something out of Eau Rouge, because his car was literally running in a straight line. It then just turned to the left and just slammed into a concrete wall at one of the most difficult parts of the racetrack, that fast run down into the Eau Rouge Radio Complex. Max Del Orco in that number 52 car, who qualified in the 11th position and was able to start making his way up. He was running in fifth at the time, is now out of the race. And what that will do is it will move Martin Petila up one position. It will move Fulvio Barrazzini, Andrew Borcher, Stephen Michaels, Yudan Rumi up one position each as well. I just got that wrong, so ignore me. But meanwhile, Iker Hapala is trying to go around the outside of Andre Borcher, wasn't able to do so. He'll probably get that job done, however, on the run down into Lecoum the next time by. Once again, I am going to try and bring Dom Duhan into this conversation very quickly. Dom, we've talked before about how there's no team orders at Team Redline, but I'm guessing you expect, the drivers respect each other anyway. Is it just a case of if you can find a way past, you can go past, but they're still going to race each other hard?
Yeah, absolutely. You've got to keep it safe, though. It's no taking teammates out. That's rule number one, I think, for all motorsport. It's certainly the same for us. So, yeah, go for it.
As Borcher is going to lose that position to Iker Hapala. Hapala is going to go around the outside on that run down into Lecoum. So move Iker Hapala now up into the eighth position. Move Andre Borcher back down into ninth. Of course, Pablo Lopez is now back into the top 10. He's got his teammate Jeremy Bootsloop actually closing up on him just a little bit. Bootsloop last time by a 149.974. Compare that to Pablo Lopez's last lap, a 150.7. Bootsloop is charging right now, Marius. In fact, I have to say Bootsloop actually, on that run down to Furlong, it's gaining even more time. That gap right now is just 3.5 tenths of a second on the racetrack as they work themselves through Furlong. Down into the Fangia chicane once again. We're going to try and go on board with Jeremy Bootsloop as they come out of the Fangia chicane, because you've got yourself a little bit of a traffic jam right now ahead of him. Pablo Lopez has got the very slow Andre Borcher ahead of him. Meanwhile, Iker Hapala is driving off into the sunset, and both Lopez and Bootsloop want to try and get past Iker Hapala as quickly as possible. If they're lucky, they can possibly both do it. As they run down into Lecoum on the next lap, they need to close up, however, before they get down into the bus stop chicane. You can just see the speed that these cars carry, and then this huge big braking zone. I see Lopez gonna look down to the inside, and will he try and go down as well? Bootsloop almost touches there Andre Borcher. That is very close between Bootsloop and Borcher. I think there was just the tiniest of taps between those two drivers. Indeed there was, but Bootsloop was able to get through that unscathed, and both radical cars was able to get past Andre Borcher at the bus stop chicane. That was a bold move by Lopez to slide down the inside. Bootsloop saw the opening, he slotted his car in and was able to get himself now up into the 10th position on the racetrack. We currently have a total of 23 cars scored on the lead lap, and Bootsloop now very close to the rear of Pablo Lopez as they work themselves down the Kenwood straightaway into Lecoum they come. Bootsloop's going to meet an easy pass there, Marius. He's now gained two positions in less than half a lap.
Yeah, and I wonder, we've talked about different pit strategies, and Jeremy seems like the fastest guy around the top 10 positions here. Of course, still coming into play that both Buteloup as well as Cotovara and Lorente right now all passed Andre Böttcher, and it looks like Böttcher's not really giving them a struggle right here. He's just seeing that his car is majorly off pace and just letting the guys around him pass. And pit strategies again. We're soon reaching the window for the two-stop strategy. Well, soon is just relative here. 44 laps to go, so expecting 44 laps in the race. We've got 30 to go, so we're expecting pit stops to happen around 3 or 4
laps to go. Sturgis just passed Atty Kerkhoff there, and he did that on the run down into Blanchimont. We're thinking there's an issue with Atty Kerkhoff. In fact, he's got a torn up front wing there, has Atty Kerkhoff. And he was falling dramatically off the pace of Luke McLean the previous couple of laps. We believe he had a little bit of an incident. Perhaps he tagged the rear of his teammate, Luke McLean, actually. We'll have a look to see whether McLean has any rear wing damage. But Atty Kerkhoff all of a sudden down into the fifth position. And, of course, he's just been passed by the guy who tried to pull away from in the championship. That is Jake Sturgios, who is now up into the fourth position on the racetrack in that Inex Racing car, Marius.
And you said it, I wonder really, he's had a little incident with Fulvio Barrazzini in the first turn, but that's not really damaged his front wing like that, so it must have been with Luke McLean, his teammate right there, and that's especially disappointing, because by his pace right now, he's further off pace than 1.5 seconds, and Fulvio Barrazzini behind him is already catching by over 1 second per lap. So definitely Sturgis won't be the only one passing Atty Kerkhoff here. So Kerkhoff with a bit of an issue, Andre Böttcher with a bit of an issue, and both are losing more than 1.5 seconds per lap. So you see how easy that can go.
And that's not the sort of thing that the Red Line guys would have wanted. They would have wanted all three of their cars to put the pressure on Hugo Lloris, try and actually force Lloris out of the top three in the standings for this race. But Kerkhoff is falling like a brick right now. Meanwhile, Christian Loren is trying to work on Pablo Lopez in the battle for 10th position on the racetrack. Last time by, Christian Loren did himself a 1:49.867. His fastest lap of the race. Pablo Lopez, a 1:50.719. I do think that Lopez has actually got more fuel than most of the guys on this field, because I don't see any damage to his car. We've not seen any incidents for him. Of course, he started pretty far down the field, so he's probably on a return to strategy anyway. He was able to get himself up into the top 10, then fell back to 11th. Of course, moved back up into 10th after that incident with Max DeLorco. Now, Christian Loren looks as though he's going to get past in the next lap or so.
So a little bit of an overview of the top 10 drivers as we are about to reach the pit stop window for the two stoppers here. Gregor Hutu, your race leader, still just under 1 second ahead of Hugo Lloris. Hugo actually, pretty much the same pace for the, at least 10, 15 laps of the race, so almost the entirety of the race. He's not exactly got the slipstream back, however, so still second for him. 7.7 seconds now is Luke McLean. Luke had a fight early with Atty Kerkhoff, his team Redline teammate, but Atty Kerkhoff with a front wing damage, been tossed down the grid, finding himself in sixth position between them. Jake Sturgis in fourth and Fulvio Barrazzini in fifth. Good race for both of them, so good points definitely for now for the championship. Morgafino in seven, Ilkka Haapala eight, Jeremy Buterloo and Pablo Lopez rounding up the top 10. And if you take a look around the top 10 standings right there, Jeremy Buterloo, Pablo Lopez, Christian Llorente, Petri Cotovara, and even the damaged car of Andre Böttcher, all within half of a second gap there. So a lot of battles going on, as we're used to see that around the top 10 positions.
Christian Llorente has been able to actually get past Pablo Lopez. And it was a bold move there by Christian Llorente to move himself into the top 10. Behind, Cotovara is going to try to go around the outside into the final chicane. That didn't work out for him. But it looks as though that Lopez is falling like a brick right now. He surely is on a one-stop strategy. Cotovara last time by did a 1:49.714. This will be a slower lap for him. He had to get right out of the gas through that sweeping, fast, right, left. That is the Fungus chicane. And in fact, Cotovara's last lap time was his fastest of the race. He will try and close back up on this long, sweeping backstretch before they get down into the bus stop chicane. It could just be on the outside line once again. He won't be able to do it. Lopez a little bit squirrely under braking here. Now you see that Cotovara is going to try and sort of line himself up nicely. Perhaps he'll try that run down into La Source. If he doesn't get it there, he will surely get it after they come through Eruj Radio. But meanwhile, this is the battle for 11th and 12th positions on the racetrack. And also, Hugo Lloris is starting to close that gap up to Hutu. We'll come back to that in a moment. We'll go on board of Petri Cotovara as they work through Eruj, flicking it to the left, then up the hill to the right, now into riding on the flick to the left once again. This is where he'll get all of that slipstream. You'll see he'll probably have to go the long way around. Lopez defending the inside line, Quartararo on the outside. He's going to almost just about clear there, and he will have to break very deep into the corner. Lopez not giving it up just yet. Quartararo finally goes past. He moves himself up into the 11th position on the racetrack. And Marius, we've seen if you're going to want to overtake here, you're going to have to try and do it on the outside of Lacombe. As already, Pablo Lopez is under pressure from Matthias Egger. He's going to sweep down the inside of him there as he's just come out of Rivage.
Yeah, and Pablo Lopez is getting an off track here, leaving the boundaries of the track, being bordered by the white lines here. And Andrea Böttcher is also going to get back at them. So you see, Böttcher has definitely got the pace, even with a damaged car, to follow these guys. But he, as well, needs to stay in the slipstream of the cars ahead to really stay close. And as long as they keep fighting, he will definitely stick on with them. Rico Latalo behind him started from the very last position in the grid, 35, and he's worked himself all the way up into 15. So a great race for the Finn driver living in Singapore. So 20 positions made up in less than half a race. That's just amazing.
Meanwhile, Hugo Lloris even has been able to close into drafting distance now of Gregor Hutu. Now, we know that neither Lloris or Hutu really run a very long 7th gear, knowing the fact that they probably spend most of their races out front. He was able to close that gap to about 2 car lengths back, however, and was working on lap number 18 of 44 right now. We're pretty much now kind of exiting that window for two-stop strategies. The window, Marius, for one-stop races, they'll kind of open anywhere between about lap number 21 and lap number 26. We expect if you're going to win a one-stopper, however, you're going to go as late as possible. So realistically, anywhere from lap 24 through to 26.
Yeah, and I'm thinking that both Gregor and Hugo will be right in that zone. And we know that Hugo is always one of the drivers who pits relatively late. But then again, Gregor's always with a full tank in the first stop, trying to make the best and maybe go even one lap longer than Hugo. So it looks like it's really coming down to the pit stop. And if you go one lap longer and you've got low amounts of fuel, your lap is going to be about 2 seconds quicker than with added fuel and new tires. So you're going to make up at least 2 seconds on that. And that can be the 2 seconds you need to leapfrog your guy ahead. However, on the track, Hugo Lewis is going to try it without going in the pits. He's going to try to get the position on the track, as Gregor's made a little bit of a mistake there in Fannier, but Hugo is going to stay behind. He thinks, no, not in the bus stop, not going to try it around the outside. And I believe Hugo's just going to try to follow him now and going to make it in Lacombe. But the way Gregor just gets out of the last turn and also out of La Source, I don't think that Hugo's just got the edge over Gregor.
Moe Garfido, by the way, goes past Atsi Kirkos and moves himself up into 6th position on the racetrack. That is one of the issues. If you're the car behind, you have to wait for the car ahead to get onto the power. And it's always going to be half a car length beforehand. And Lloris lost out a little bit there. I think, actually, he placed his car wrong into the bus stop chicane. That lost some momentum all the way through sector one of this racetrack. Again, he's closed that gap up to about 0.2 of a second, about 3 car lengths as they come down into Lacombe once again. But the way that he's got to run that last couple of corners and also turn number one last source, he's gonna have to set that car up to work better on the exit of it. Sacrifice a little bit more, allow Hutu to get onto the power when he wants to, but do it in such a way that you can get onto the power a little bit earlier and keep that momentum going for him. Great battle for the race lead, however, as we approach half race distance. And also Moe Garfido, Marius, back in the Pro Series, Filo, he was always the bridesmaid. He didn't actually win a race. However, he was astonishingly good at this racetrack, and he's knocking on the door, actually, of the top five. If he can just go a little bit longer in this race than Barrazzini, for example, and close that gap up a little bit more.
He's had a great season in the Pro Series, you just said it. One of the fastest drivers besides of Richie Stanaway there, who's won the season. But I think Mogar's now pretty much reached the pinnacle of his racing pace right here. If you take a look at the lap times, he's not going to get much quicker than this, and all the guys ahead of him are at least doing his times. So gaining positions now will be a lot harder, as he's still around 4 seconds down to P5. But he said it, long race to go. We're not even reaching half time here. 3 laps to go until that. So a lot of time for Moe Garfido, maybe going a little bit longer as well in the first stint. And he's definitely got a shot at the top five here. We've seen him in the Pro Series here. We've seen him right now. And it looks like he's definitely got the pace for doing that.
Hugo Lloris attacked the curb there on the bus stop chicane. Used a lot of that curb. And I'm wondering, he might just get himself a little bit of underside damage because of that. We're going to get a good impression of his straight line speed as they come down into Lacoon once again. They're working themselves on the Kemmel straightaway on lap number 20. Once again, closing that gap. And you can see there, Hootie just weaving around, trying to make sure that Louise doesn't use that draft. Of course, he can do that. He can use whatever line he wants until Louise is in a position to make a pass. And then you can only make one move. But for the time being, Louise still sat in that second position on the racetrack, still sat about 3/10 behind. It doesn't look as though he got any damage there for hitting that curb on the exit of the bus stop chicane. Luke McLean still sat in that third position, Marius. He actually right now is doing faster lap times than Sturgeon, but still losing about 3/10 of a second a lap to Louise and Hooter ahead of him.
Yeah, but he said 8 seconds down. We're at half point of the race. With 8 seconds down, you're almost facing yourself an impossible thing to do at the end of the race, because you need to gain almost half a second per lap to really have a chance, and you still need to do the overtake then. So with 8 seconds down, I think Luke McLean, all he does right now is just try to stick to the third position here and not let Jake Sturgis get much closer. As Jake Sturgis, of course, is only 5 seconds down, but then himself, he needs to fight against Fulvio Barrazzini now, as Fulvio Barrazzini looks to be faster than Sturgis at the moment, and he's only 1.7 seconds down, and also behind him, Mogafilo, Atsi Kirchhoff, and Ilkka Haapala.
Alexi Loma brings his car back onto the racetrack. He has scored 9 laps down right now. Scored 1,050 seconds, actually, behind Max DeLorco on the racetrack. Meanwhile, we are now working ourselves on lap number 21. Luis gets himself a good run there out of Lasorda, but then gets himself a big wiggle out of it. This will be interesting as they work themselves up the hill. You will see Hootie working around the racetrack once again to make sure that Louise doesn't get that gap. This is as close as he has been, however. Will he try and look to the outside line? This is the battle for the race lead. Louise is going to go to the outside. It'll be the last late breakers, and Louise isn't quite close enough. Hootie supreme there on the brakes on the inside line. But that is the first time that Louise has been able to pull his car alongside Hootie since lap number one of this race, Marius.
Yeah, and you see, you can always try to make it around the outside, but then you have to rely on the person on the inside to brake earlier than you do. And the way Gregor just braked is just right on the borderline of what's possible on the inside. And then he's kind of letting the car slide towards the apex, and you won't find yourself any room on the outside, so you're not going to get past like that. You just have to rely on the guy on the inside just to brake a little bit earlier, so you can do that sweeping, braking into the turn late maneuver to get the run for the left-hander once again. And even if you do that, we've seen it with a couple of guys earlier, even if you're on the left, then the next turn is still a right-hander, so you're going to face the exactly same problem.
Very quickly, we're going to have a look through the gains and losses in this race so far. Once again, Hootie, of course, up one position. Louise down one position. Jake Sturgis now up 10 positions. Jeremy Boothloop, 20 positions from where he started. He started in 29th, now running in the 9th position on the racetrack. Great drive there for the Radical car. Petri Quartararo up 14 positions. Riccardo Taro, who's up 20 positions. He did that all at the start of the race, however, not gained any positions since. Andre Borcher, one of the big losers in the top 10. He has lost 7 positions. Petila has lost 15 positions from his starting spot. So it looks as though that it's kind of up and down here at Spa-Francorchamps, working on lap number 22. We expect to be about 4 to 5 laps away from pit stops right now, as Luis really is abusing that curb on the exit of Radion. Once again, he's going to get himself a good run. He's not going to be close enough this time by, however, in the battle for the race lead. Once again, he will try and slot it to the outside. He won't be anywhere near close enough. He just wanted to make sure he didn't run over the rear of Gregor Hootie. But meanwhile, we're going to hand it down to pit road. Rob and Atsi Kirchhoff pits.
On relatively early pit sub for the Dutch driver here, but I think especially with the front wing damage, he's been tossed down the grid equally like Andrea Vecchia. They've only been 3 seconds apart on the line. I think both of them are looking to fix the damage as soon as possible, but Vecchia is still out, and I wonder if he's just been a bit too late, because he's not really far down from guys like Matthias Egger and Pablo Lopez, so he could get back at them. But I think the later he's pitting right now, he's not going to make up any time with the bent rear wing.
He comes back out onto the racetrack just ahead of Marco Petila, but Petila's going to go around the outside of him, breeze around him as they work themselves onto the Kemmel straightaway. Lap number 22 for these drivers. So Petila's going to get that job done. However, Kirchhoff might try and have a look back as they come down into the Lacoum. Not going to be close enough. So he's going to come out into traffic there, actually, Kirchhoff, and that might hurt him just a little bit. Your top five, Gregor Hutu still leading the way. The gap between himself and Luis, less than half a second on the racetrack. Luke McLean in third, Jake Sturgios in fourth. Fulvio Barrazzini rounds out your top five. And that pit window is getting closer and closer and closer. We're now at the halfway point of this race. So if you want to make it just a simple half and half pit stop, this is your time to come on toward pit road. Luis, once again, he struggles there in La Source quite a lot, Marius, actually. And I think if he can nail La Source, he'll be good on and to actually make a pass on Hutu. He loses about 0.2 seconds there every lap, however.
Yeah, and that's exactly where Gregor is good. You said it, La Source as well as Bastop. And if you're good in La Source, if you're not going to make an exit mistake there, you're not going to let the guy behind you get much closer. And even we've seen Hugo being relatively close, still with a good exit of Gregor last lap, and he couldn't get by, so he needs to be a lot closer than that to have a real chance here, and I don't see it happening.
And now into, say, the second half of this race. Pit stop-wise, the biggest question, of course, is going to be who is going to get that job done. Will it be Hutu? Will it be Hugo Lewis? Let's not forget, Marius, at VIR, Hutu was able to overtake Lewis on pit road. So even if they both come in on the same lap, there is a possibility that one could leapfrog the other. Hutu, arguably, however, is the best driver on pit road itself.
Yeah, and there's still that variance you said on the pit stop. Even if you do the same pit stop, your pit stop can still vary to just about 1.5 seconds. And depending on where you stop, if you stop exactly in front of your pit marshal, exactly aligned with the pit wall or the garage, that all comes into play, really. And if you stop exactly there, you're going to get a really good pit stop time. That's all you need. And then again, we may not forget a very, very narrow pit entry and exit here. We're going to keep an eye on both the race leaders here. Is anyone going to make a move for the pits? No, not in lap 23. They are not. And we're going to go for lap 24 right now. And I believe it's either going to be 24 or 25 for both. And yeah, then it's just a question of who's going to get the better pit stop here. And we've seen Hugo and Gregor have been relatively calm here, especially Hugo not trying anything silly here at Gregor, even though he's been almost side by side. And I think that will definitely change. I mean, he's still going to be right at his tail even if he messes up the pit stop. And I think then, I mean, he's got nothing to lose, really. He needs the 50 points. He cannot afford to come second once again. And even if he DNFs, he's still going to stay comfortably in second. Atsi Kirchhoff's had a bad race so far. So he needs to risk anything he can right here. That's just it. And he needs to get a good pit stop first, because if he messes up the pit stop, it's all going to be over like that.
Don't forget the 2012 Spa race where Luis actually passed Hutu. In fact, the 2011 race where he passed Hutu into La Source. So he can make that pass, Luis. However, you've got to try and make sure that you can get that car working for him. And so we are now closing in on that pit window. We'll keep an eye out to see all the guys coming down onto pit road. Don't forget, if you head over to isowc.org/live, keep up to date with all of the live time. You'll also see when your favourite driver makes that journey onto pit road as well. You can keep in contact with us on Twitter. Use the hashtag iRacingWCS to keep in contact with us throughout the entire World Championship Series. Onto the backstretch once again for Hutu and Luis, your two top drivers, as we expect them to come to pit road in the next 2 to 3 laps time. That gap has eked out just a tiny bit. Hutu, of course, for his last couple laps before he comes on pit road, always one of the fastest on the racetrack. They're going to make that right-hand flick. Do either of them come in? No, they don't. So they stay out for another lap. We'll keep an eye out on Luke McLean. Will he make that journey onto pit road this time by? Normally, he comes in a lap or two earlier than the other two. No, he doesn't. He stays out on the racetrack. Jake Sturgios running in the fourth position. He's working himself through the bus stop chicane, and he stays out as well. Fulvio Barrazzini stays out. Mo Garofalo in the 27 car. We expect him to go longer than anyone else, and he right now stays out on the racetrack. Hepard, however, is onto pit road, and he's going to make his one and only pit stop of the day, as Boosloop stays out as well. Going to keep an eye out on Iker Hepard. In fact, we'll go on board of him as he slows down 37 miles an hour. It is a long, long pit road here at Spa. He's going to get himself 4 fresh tyres. He will top up with fuel for the end of the race as well. Lap number 24 for him. He's the first, really, of the one-stoppers, the blink barriers. Everyone else will be in very soon.
taking a look at who has indeed been in the pits. A couple of drivers being tossed all the way down in the standings. Ilkka Haapala in the pits. Marcus Catton just moved into the pits. Matthias Egger down pit road as well. So Atsi Kirchhoff, who's made the earlier pit stop, is got a repaired front wing. So the pits, the pit crew has indeed done a good job on his car. Andrea Böttcher, who's got the damaged rear wing, is still out, and he's running a comfortable pace at 1 minute 50.5, which isn't particularly quick, so I wonder why he's not pitting earlier. Lap 25 this time, we're on board with Hugo Lewis from Team My3AD Gaming, following Team Redline driver Gregor Lewis, and the view you're getting now is exactly the view you're getting all the season long. This is exactly how it looks, and Hugo is going to try and move around the outside.
Oh!
Again, late braking by him, but you can't complete this. You just cannot get past on the outside right there. Gregor's making a narrow line on the inside, not leaving him any room, and just like that, it's all the same again.
So what we did there is we just merged two drivers. Well done there, Marius. But Luis actually gets himself a better exit. No, he doesn't. He's still wiggling that car. He really is loose out of La Source there. But they'll come down into Eruz once again. Lap number 26. Ahutu's actually gone a couple of laps further than we expected him to. We thought Ahutu was going to be the first to pit out of these two drivers. And a little bit of a mistake there for Hutu, and here comes Luis around the outside, battle for the race lead, and Hugo Luis, will he go back to the point? He'll be clear, but look at this, they almost come together there. Luis wasn't able to get any room there, and Hutu lives to fight another day, but Luis had the opportunity to take the race lead. Insanely late braking, however, for Gregor Hutu, and he just didn't allow Luis really to turn into that corner. Meanwhile, very quickly, we're going to take it down to pit road. Rob Koss is standing by, and Jake Sturgis has made his one and only pit stop of the day. Anything happened with him? And Andre Borch is in as well.
No, he just dropped in, checked his steering, got four freshies, new boots, and
went. I'm going to have to interrupt you. Hugo Lewis has actually been able to get past Gregor Hutu. Sorry about that. Lewis at the farthest chicane, able to get past Hugo Lewis. Past Gregor Hutu. Perhaps the best pass we have seen all season on the outside. Hugo Lewis back to the race lead, and you could say perhaps Hutu might be a little bit light on fuel here.
I was just about to say that exactly. It looks like he's saving fuel on the straights, and that allowed him to get past. That's definitely not a spot you want to get past right now, and this has been exactly the same situation going into Le Combe. He's not really done a big mistake there, but he's also lost the time, and Hugo is pitting ahead of him, and that's exactly what he wanted.
So, Hugo Lewis coming onto pit road, and almost Hutu runs into the rear of him. They are nose to tail as they come onto pit road. We'll get ourselves a replay of what is probably part of the WCS this year. On the outside of the Fungi chicane, Hugo Lewis passing Gregor Hutu, the My3AD car over the Team Redline car.
This and the Redline car's running on
fumes. Critical part of the race, and Hutu is critical now. He's got to get into his box. They're both in, both onto the jack at the same time. It looks as though the Hutu's down off the jacks a little bit earlier before Lewis. Who's going to be the first one to get off pit road? It's going to be Lewis, and Hutu loses about a second there. Hugo Lewis is your new race leader, and I think there for Hutu, he had to restart that car because he said he was on actual fumes and he was actually choking there as he brought that car into pit road, Marius.
Yeah, and it looked like he's really taken a very, very safe entry as he's approaching your pit marshal. You always need to pit at very close distance to the pit marshal, and if he's really running on fumes, he's not been able to restart the engine once it's cut off, and the race will be over, so he needs to get the pit stop exactly right. And we're going to take a look at what exactly happened there, but he's lost about two and a half seconds on the pit stop, and if Hugo can now do a couple of good lap times and get the tires to work, this will be a very, very hard race for Gregor Hutu to even get close again, and we've just seen how hard it is to overtake here, so that's definitely a race-changing move.
You saw a replay up on your screen there of that pass between Gregor Hutu and Hugo Lewis, as Lewis was able to get himself to the race lead. A beautiful pass there on the outside of the Fungi chicane, a very difficult place to try and make the move. And Luke McLean right now is scored as your race leader. He, however, brings that car down onto pit road, and he's going to relinquish that race lead. Luke McLean leading a lap here at Circuit de Spa-Francorchamps, down to 37 miles an hour for him. However, Rob,
for Gregor Hütte, he had to make sure he stopped perfectly in that pit box. If he was even an inch too far ahead, that would have been race over for him, because he was out of fuel. He wouldn't have been able to reverse.
That was one of the best pit stops I've seen, considering he had no room for error. It was very, very dialed in, stopped on his mark perfectly, so he got himself back out. Lost a bit of time, though, so we'll see if he can get it back on the track.
Right now, so McLean is back out onto the racetrack. Fulvio Barrazzini as well on pit row, and is going to be out of for him. So the gap between Hugo Lloris and Gregor Hütte, after they made their pit stop, 2.4 seconds on the racetrack. Marius, if we're going to see some Gregor Hütte magic, it's going to start right now, working lap 28 of 44.
Yeah, and you say it needs to start right now, because you're not going to gain any time, because these guys are just so close together on pace. Even if Gregor gains a 10th per lap, it's definitely not going to be enough right here. He needs to get that Gregor Hütte magic to work, as he's just about 2.4 seconds down, and 2.4 seconds, and we've got 15 laps to go here. 17 laps to go, in fact. So a couple of laps for him at least to go, but at a rate of 2.10 per lap.
Oh no, Hütte's off! Hütte just losing the car there on the exit of the left-hander before Fuhr get himself onto the curb. He was able to just keep it off the wall. That is the first mistake we have seen for Gregor Hütte in a long, long time. Luke McLean goes past Gregor Hütte. Now, surely Hütte will find himself back past Luke McLean, but I can't remember the last time when Hütte made a mistake like that, Marius.
Yeah, but that just shows the pressure he's on here. I mean, he can certainly afford to get second here. We've just been talking about that in the pre-race show. He can afford to get second, but by God, he cannot afford to DNF his car right here. And he can also not afford to let Luke McLean pass. I believe still not talking about any strategies from the team here, letting Gregor pass here. But I think he's still going to be quicker than Luke McLean like that. He's just going to get passed once again. And but still, he cannot afford to do anything like that. You've seen how close he's been to the wall. That can just happen like that, and the race will be over. And he's now 7.5 seconds down. And that is a big relief for Hugo Lloris, as well as for all the guys following Hugo Lloris, fans of Hugo Lloris here. Because at a rate of 7.5 seconds here, Gregor needs to gain over half a second per lap. And I frankly cannot see that happening right now. He's still in second, though, so, big brief there, big sigh of relief here that the car has not gone into the wall. But, still, I mean, that just shows how much pressure is on the drivers here.
Meanwhile, Mogar Fio has lost himself about two or three positions there in one corner. He's lost position to Matias Egger, to Pablo Lopez, and I believe he might have lost position to Andy Kirchhoff there as well. I tell you what, I'm wondering to see what the commentary looks like from our friends over at iRacing Brazil when that happened. If you think I was over energetic, I'm sure those guys would have been exactly the same. But Gregor Hütte down into the second position, that is the big story of the day. And he is still pushing that car as hard as it will go, hoping that Lloris maybe makes a mistake at some point in this race and he can recapitalize. Of course, lap traffic might come into play in this race. Blue flag orders are in place of the World Championship Series. I will bring Dom Doohan, the team principal for Team Redline, back into the conversation. He's been watching the race with us as McLean this time goes sideways. But Dom, really one very rare issue there for Gregor Hütte. We haven't seen that in a long time. Very lucky to keep it at the wall.
Yeah, I haven't seen Gregor do that for, well, I can't remember the last time I've seen that, but good move to keep it out of the wall. I think Gregor's just going to settle for second place. Still good points, he's still got a good lead, so good race.
And of course, we did say at the start of this race that even if Hütte finished second to Lloris in every race from now on, Hütte will still win the championship. Do you think that's going through Hootie's mind right now?
I think as you get closer to the end of the championship, he'll start thinking like that, but you know, he still wants to make sure it's a bigger margin.
Meanwhile, Martin Petila is going to get himself past Jeremy Buteloup there. He's now up into the sixth position. Buteloup now down into the seventh position on the racetrack. And Petila, I mean, he's been up and down in this race, Marius. At one point, he faded away just a little bit. Of course, he right now is the leader, Juracar. Now, Max Lorca is out of the race. Started in fifth, fell well down the standings at one point. Now back up and running in at the sixth position on the racetrack. However, quite a long way behind Jake Sturgis, 8.2 seconds.
Yeah, 8.2 seconds, so it's at that point of the race, I mean, you already need about 2 or 3 seconds to the guy ahead to really get a chance here. So if you find yourself after this pit stop in a spot like Jake Sturgis right now, 8 seconds down to the front, 8 seconds down to the rear, I'm sorry, but even at a really good pace here, you just need to settle down and take the position you can. Hope for any mistakes, hope for anything being handed to you. But at 8 seconds of a gap, the pace is just not different enough. I mean, you're running at a good pace, and even if you're running at a great pace, you're only going to be 10 faster or what per lap. So it's not going to be a big difference here. At Kirko Forever, I just want to talk quickly about the Team Redline driver. He's got the little bit of front wing damage, had that repaired on his pit stop, finding himself in 9th position right now, only 5 seconds down to Matti Pietelle, 3 positions ahead, and he might even get a shot at getting the 6th position there, as he's shown a very remarkable pace in the first couple of laps before the damage, and he's not particularly far off, and I consider that 4 seconds behind this 3-car train might be very well possible, as I think between Pietele, Buteloup and Harpala, that's also a chicken to pluck and a couple of fights brewing up.
Meanwhile, Pablo Lopez is out of the race. A little bit of contact, I believe, actually, with Matias Eggers. They came down into Lacoum. Lopez had to take the escape road there in Lacoum itself. We'll get the replay up on your screen in just a moment. And then Lopez looks as though he had a second incident there with Egger as they came out of Lacoum. I don't think Egger realised that Lopez was bringing his car back onto the racetrack. The two came back together. That spun Lopez around, spun him into the wall, and Lopez is out of the race in that Radical. I think he's actually out now. Yes, he is. He is out indeed in that number 9 Radical car, running way down the order. He will finish in about the 24th position on the racetrack. To run through your top 10, Hugo Luis now with a 7.4 second gap over Gregor Hutu. For those of you who are just joining us, Hutu led at the conclusion of lap number 1, passing Luis on the outside of Lacoum, and then led pretty much until the first pit stop, when Luis made a big bold manoeuvre into the final chicane. Gregor Hutu also ran out of fuel coming onto pit road, was able to get his car into the pit box, but was about 1.3 seconds longer, and then had a huge moment as he came out of Rivard just a couple of laps ago, putting him well down the standings. Luke McLean running in a solid third position right now. Fulvio Barrazzini in fourth. Jake Sturgis was in fifth. Martin Petila in sixth position. Jeremy Buteloup in seventh. He's worked himself way up the field from where he started this race. The number 7 car started it all the way down in the 29th position. Our biggest move of the day. Iker Hapala runs in eighth. Atte Kirchhoff in ninth. Petru Cotavara rounds out your top 10. What a drive right now by Jeremy Buteloup, up from 29th up into 7th, Marius.
Yeah, and a couple of big movers here, as well as Rico Alatalo, a couple of positions gained for him, or not just a couple of positions, but he started at the last possible grid position, number 21 for him, place 35 on the grid. He's moved himself up into 13th position, and that's a whole lot of positions gained. Andrew Slocum moved himself into 14th from 32nd. Christian Llorente made up 5 positions. Matthias Egger made up 13 positions. He came from 24th, finding himself into 10, in position number 10. 25th start position for Patrick Cotavara, all the way up into 10th. And you just see, well, I mean, all the guys from 10th position all the way down into 14th. 5 guys, they've all made up more than 5, 6, 7 positions. And it shows, even if you start at the very back of the grid, just like Rico Alatalo or Andrew Slocum, you can still finish a respectable result all the way in the top 20, maybe even in the top 10 if you get a great race. Jeremy Buteloup, the best example, now in 7th position, and he started in 29th. And the race is so long, you're definitely going to get a good run. You're definitely going to get your chance if you have the pace, if you have the performance to gain positions. You're going to get your shot at that.
Cheers, Liam. We'll be right back after this short message from our friends over at iRacing. Enjoy it.
Simulated racing can be awesome, but can also be kind of a free-for-all. Interestingly, auto racing faced the same problem in its earlier days. Whether it was on the back roads, the beaches, or the city streets, the racing was fun. But there was always a certain level of chaos and danger, until some folks came along and put some order to all of this. Stuff like official racetracks, regulations about weight and equipment, and enforcement of standards. That's what gave us high-speed excitement, fast-paced action, and photo finishes. That's when racing became racing. The guys over at iRacing.com have made the same transformation in the world of sim racing. Sure, they've got the most accurate tracks and realistic cars out there, but that's just the start. See, iRacing analyzes the performance and results of each driver in every race, so you can be sure you're always placed in races where the competition will be tight, and that those reckless drivers who ruin it for us all are kept in the pits. Not to mention that with over 45,000 active members already in their vast community, you can find races day and night, so you can always get in on the action. You can even join a league of your favorite series. And since updates are always automatic, you don't have to worry about software and can focus on the track. Zip up your fire suit and check out iRacing.com.
Looking high above Circuit Spa-Francorchamps as we're entering the closing stages of the 10th round of the iRacing.com World Championship Grand Prix Series. Will Vincent, Rob Cluss, Marius Donnebeck in the booth for this race. And we are, say, working right now on lap number 33 of 44 here at the longest track that we go to all season long. Let's give a shout out to the sponsors of this race. First of all, to iRacing. Head over to iRacing.com right now to get yourself half price off your first 3 months membership just by going to iRacing.com. And also shout out to our friends over at ETV and to Team Redline for World Championship Tipping. Head over to teamredline.co.uk/tipping and get involved with the action before every single race. That gap right now between Hugo Lewis and Gregor Hutu is still 7.3 seconds on the racetrack. It looks as though Hutu has given up the ghost for this race, we think. But still, you know, Lewis seeing very respectable lap times. Last time, 1 minute 49.114. He's not breeding EV just yet, Marius.
Yeah, and if you think we're talking a bit too much about the front runners here, and you're wondering where your teammates or your drivers you're following are in the race, you're of course invited to go over to isowc.org/live, the official Glacier TV live timing here as well from the isowc.org website. You're finding your fellow drivers right over there with gaps, last laps, fastest laps, as well as the pit stop count.
Indeed, yes. So most of the drivers have made just one stop here today. Marcin Ciciola, however, has made two stops in this race, and that's dropped him right back down the standings. He was running in the sixth position at one point. He is now down in 16th, trying to work on Andre Borgia. In fact, he's going to look to the outside of him as they work themselves down the Kemmel straightaway. Once again, on the outside, easily going to be clear there. Past Borges, it's a slow car. Daniel Lopez as well there. Very, very slow on the racetrack. Looks as though he might have actually just hit the wall because he's really lost speed there. I think he's actually going to put his car out of the race. Daniel Lopez scored 24 laps down, had some issues early on in the going. Fulvio Barrazzini, once again, a great drive by him in that number 10 Triple M car, running himself in the fourth position on the racetrack. You're going to have to say that, for me, the two standout drivers outside the normal people, I mean, Stephen Michaels and Fulvio Barrazzini for me, really have come into their own this season. This time, Barrazzini's going to get the upper hand over Stephen Michaels. He's had a difficult day, scored 20th position in that Twister Racing car. Barrazzini, stone job once again by him.
A look at the top 10 right now as we have finished 34 laps in this 44-lap race. Hugo Lewis, your race leader, still 7.5 seconds ahead of Gregor Hutu. Luke McLean completing the top three, so two red line, one My3ID in the top three. Fulvio Barrazzini, stellar race from the Italian driver in fourth position. Jake Sturgis in fifth. Jeremy Buteloup in sixth. Ilkka Haapala, seven. Atsi Kirchhoff in eight. Patrick Cotovara in 9 and Matthias Egger completing the top 10. If you're wondering where guys like Pablo Lopez, Yoni Turmela, Simon Cattell, they have all retired from the race, as well as Max Dell'Orco, Alexia Loma, Daniel Lopez, Timo Ivonen, Jason Lovett, Davide Korps, Yudai Narumi, Paul Ilbring, Enzo Bonito, as well as Mr. Koala Bear, Ben Cornett, the last of the retirees here. So, Will, we've actually got 14 cars no longer on the lead lap. Ricardo Castriedo still driving in 22nd position, but 13 retirees, third of the grid here. In fact, I think Spa has taken its toll on this one.
Spa always is a big car eater. Of course, we had a couple of incidents on the first lap of the race. We had a two-car incident down at La Source. We had a small incident down into La Coombe. Then we had that incident, which two separate incidents actually, down into the bus stop chicane on lap number one, which took out a total of six cars. of course the bus stop being the tightest place on the racetrack, and it all started with a two-car incident, which then had a separate four-car incident, which drives trying to find their way around, and that actually helped people like Rico Italo, who's been able to get himself so far up the grid. People like Jeremy Buteloup, who's been able to make a ton of positions, just working themselves, weaning themselves through the traffic. In fact, Miguel Martin actually had to do a drive-through penalty and came out ahead of some of the guys he was ahead of in the racetrack because they were so slow through that section. Meanwhile, we're going to turn our attention to Iker Hapala and Jeremy Buteloup right now. Buteloup scored in the sixth position, Iker Hapala scored in seventh. And it looks to say that Hapala is trying to close up to Buteloup. He's got a very good car in the first sector of the lap, has the Orion Racing car. But the radical car of Buteloup is a lot stronger in sectors 2 and 3, Marius. And what this means is that Hapala just can't get close enough to try and make that pass.
Yeah, he really can't. And it's the same for all the drivers in this grid. You need to get close to get the pass done. Sounds logical, but it really is. I mean, you're not going to get the pass done from 2 or 3 car lengths away. And especially on a track like Spa, where you've got much opportunities to get the slipstream, you need to be very close, as both of the cars are braking heavy and braking late for the turn coming up. Talking especially about Lecomte, Lesueur, and the bus stop chicane. So you're not going to get any pass done by just plunging down the inside, as we've seen on other different tracks here. And that's just going to be the majority of the passes being made by mistakes, and by mistakes of your fellow competitors ahead of you. But you're still going to get lucky maybe if you're just close enough, you're going down the inside, and a little bit of an issue for you or for the driver ahead, and there's a position switch coming up. And I believe we're going to take a look again at the start of the race, so we're going to rewind about 1 hour back, as Hugo Lewis has still been in pole position then, Gregor Hutt has still been second, and we're going to take a look from Luke McLean here, the Australian driver who runs in third position here. He started in third as well, and yeah, you're maybe asking, top three are just the same, so it sounds like a boring race here, but Hugo Lewis has had a big fight with Gregor Hutt for the majority of the race. He's come out first again after a mistake from Gregor Hutt, and yeah, Luke McLean is still in third, so that's going pretty good for these guys.
So you saw there at the start, McLean actually had to use that inside line as they were all bunching up behind him. That's where Kirchhoff had his incident, which dropped him down the field as it allowed Marty Petilia to get past him. And really there, and then you saw ahead of them, you see it from the onboard of Luke McLean, that Hooter just darts that car to the outside line, works on the outside into Lacombe over Hugo Lewis, last late breakers, and we saw that a little bit later on in the race as well. When Lewis is on the outside line, he couldn't do that same move back on Hooter because Hooter was just so dominant on the brakes. When Hooter was on the outside line, he was able to sweep past and around and get that job done. So working right now on lap number 37 of 44. And Hooter's actually closed that gap by 2 seconds in the last 5 or 6 laps. It looks as though that finally Lewis is starting to ease off the pace just a little bit. His last lap, a 1:48.804. Compare that to Hooter, a 1:48.771 for him. Hooter's fastest lap of the race, that is a 1:48.537. And he did that just before he made his first pit stop of the day. But really, Hooter is still pushing, hoping that Lewis might either be a little bit light on fuel or might make a mistake in the later stages of this race.
Yeah, but there's not going to be much later stages than this, as well as we've only got 7 laps to go, just starting the 38th lap of the 44-lap race. So, not just a couple of laps to go, but 5.2 seconds down the gap between Hugo Lewis and Gregor Hutu. And I'm pretty sure that Hugo's just going to take it a little bit safer right now, and break a little bit earlier, and just take it a little bit easier here, not to risk anything unnecessary here. So Gregor Hutu's definitely going to try to close in, but I believe with a gap of 5 seconds, that's going to be a hard thing to do.
So we are closing in now on the last 5 laps of this race. We still have a total of 29 cars scored on the lead lap. Mo Garofalo is the last of them. Of course, he had a great first half of the race before having an incident on pit road, doing himself a little bit of a David Coulthard and slamming into the guardrail. Wes Richard in the 51 car, he rounds out your top 20. But moving on, we are going to go have a look. Actually, we've got a car on pit road. That is Simon Cattell. Brought his car back on pit road. He's had a horrible day here today. He scored multiple laps down. I'm having a look through timing and scoring, actually. That battle continues between Bootaloop and Ikahapala. But still, Bootaloop is so good in the second sector of this racetrack, Marius, that Ikahapala just can't get close to him to make that pass happen.
The same situation as a couple of laps ago. You said it, he's not going to get close enough, and he's always just 0.7 seconds at the line, and that's the same thing we've seen between Hugo Lewis and Gregor Hutto earlier, but then at a certain point, Hugo's just got close enough to gain from the slipstream, and Ilka needs to get to that point, and I believe he's not going to get much chance to do so, as Atsi Kirchhoff has caught up to him. He's got a lot of slipstream there going towards bus stop chicane. Through Blanchimont right now, I believe Atsi's not going to make a try right now, but he looks like certainly close enough to get a move into Le Comte.
Meanwhile, Marty Petila just did a hootie there, getting very sideways, according to just before they came down into Pouin, and lost himself 2.5 seconds to the rear of Dion Burgess. Burgess and Sacombe has been having an interesting battle. Sacombe's actually just started to pull away from Dion Burgess in the battle for the 13th position on the racetrack. But a very scary moment there for Marty Petila in that Azure car. Very lucky to keep it out of the wall. Almost exactly the same as what happened with Gregor Hutto. But meanwhile, Jeremy Bootsley over Ikahapala. This time, it looks like Ikahapala is going to be a lot closer. He's going to at least have a chance to try and dart to that outside line. He will, in fact, do so. In fact, he could have actually gone down to the inside there. Now they're going to be side by side. Ikahapala, will he get that job done? They're going to be side by side into the corner. Side by side for the second part of it. Of course, however, Bootsley will have the inside line to the next part of the corner. And he touches there with Atsi Kirchhoff. So Kirchhoff might have a tiny bit of suspension damage there. But Kirchhoff is sat there waiting, ready for either of these two drivers to make a mistake. But for Ikahapala, he actually could have gone down that inside line into Le Comte, because Bootsloop was already moving his car to the left. At that point, he wouldn't have been able to move it back to the right, Marius. And Ikahapala, if he used a bit more heads-up driving, could have just darted that car to the right. Easy pass it would have been for him.
Yeah, but, I mean, easy pass is always relative. And in a situation like that, you're still running at a higher heart rate, a high adrenaline level, and you need to make exactly the right decision in split seconds of time. So I believe it's not been too wrong, but you're running at 180 kilometers an hour through a turn, which is barely flat out if you're going alone, and going side by side there, I mean, it can always happen like that. And Atsi Kirchhoff is now right at the tail of Ikahapala again, trying to make the move in the bus stop chicane, and he needs to gain positions. He's side by side on the right side, Ikahapala on the left, but I believe now Atsi's going to get the better exit. But wait, guys, it's not over yet. Ikahapala still on side by side between him and Atsi Kirchhoff on the line, just a couple of tenths gap. So Ikahapala, I think, is still not really out of contention here, as he's now got the slipstream into Le Comte.
Indeed, yes. In fact, we'll go on board with Ikahapala to work themselves through Air Rouge. That left flick, now the right, into Radio on left once again. Here comes Ikahapala back on the charge. Now, you know Kirchhoff is going to be a lot more defensive. Ikahapala on that outside line. Will he try and get that job done back over to the Team Red Line driver? He will be clear, so he can now take whatever line he wants into the corner. Ikahapala goes a little bit wide, actually, there. And it's not going to hurt him too much, because now Kirchhoff will have to stay behind until at least into Rivage. But Kirchhoff back down into the 8th position. And, of course, we know that the Red Line cars don't actually have that tall of a 7th gear. Ikahapala, let's not forget, he's had to work himself through this field here today. He started this race in the 10th position. Now he's running in the 7th position on the racetrack. Kirchhoff, he was thinking that he'd be running in the top 4, wouldn't need that draft gear at all.
Yeah, and I believe Atsi is completely enraged right here. He's been 4 seconds down to these guys at the end of the pit stops, and he's worked himself all the way up right to the end of the car of Ikahapala. So he's trying to chase him down right now, but just by that little couple of moves right there, he's lost the draft, and he's lost the sight, in fact, of Jeremy Bootaloop. So Bootaloop all the way up into the distance, 4 seconds ahead of these two guys. And at that point right now, I'm going to start 41st lap next time by. I believe Atze thought he's going to get the two of them. And now he's not even got Ilka, and he's still got a handful with him.
So on to lap number 41 then for those drivers. Hugo Lewis is already out of Le Comte as he works himself down into Rivage once again. Hugo Lewis actually setting his fastest lap of the race the last time by, a 1:48.444. Hootie's fastest lap of the race, however, he set that at 1:48.378. So the red line driver would have had the speed, Marius. If he didn't make that mistake, the corner off the Rivage, then actually he could have been within touching distance right now. We could have set ourselves up for a great showdown, because Hutu probably would have closed a little bit of a gap. Behind them, however, Acti Kirchhoff is trying to go three wide. He's going to get past Jeremy Bootle. No, you get past actually Hiko Hapala there, and now he's going to work on two. Jeremy Bootsloop, and he already is 3.6 seconds up the road. That is how much two laps stuck behind cost Acti Kirchhoff, Marius.
Yeah, and right now, I mean, he can drive his heart out at this rate. He's still 3.5 seconds down now, and with 3.5 laps to go, I don't think he'll get Jeremy Bootsloop, even if he's quicker right now. So, that train has left the station, I'm afraid.
So, let's say last couple of laps to go in this race. And talk about what we were saying before there, before we moved on. And Hootie, if he actually didn't make that mistake, where he almost put that car into the wall, he would be right there within draft distance right now of Hugo Lloris. Now, we know how good onto the brakes Hootie is. We know that his car isn't the best in the draft, however. Do you think Hootie would have actually been able to find a way past Lloris in this race?
You still keep asking me questions. I've got no answer. They've both got the talent, definitely the raw talent to fight each other, and definitely Gregor would have a chance of fighting Hugo. I mean, no doubt of that. But we'll never find out, at least here. I think 5 seconds of a gap between Hugo and Gregor. Gregor once again a little bit of a faster lap time last time by, but 2.5 laps to go. I don't think Hugo really cares about that. I mean, he can just do a 1:49 right now and just finish the race carefully, not risking any car injuries there, and taking home the victory and the very important 50 points here. He's only going to get 10 points gain, so he's still going to be down 89 points, and 6 races to go. 10 times 6 would be 60 points. Even if he wins all the races and Gregor comes second, that's not going to be enough.
But, of course, Lloris back into winning form. Winning 2 races in a row, that's going to be a huge confidence boost for that My3ID driver.
Next race, of course, coming up in 2 weeks, but we'll disclose that later on the prestigious Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Of course, the road course we're going to attack there. Very slippery, very hard to drive circuit, I find at least. So I wonder if the pace will be so close right there. However, not talking about the next race yet. 2 laps to go, not yet the white flag out. 2 laps to go at this race. 43rd lap just started off 44. Means 2 times through Rouge, 2 times through Rivage, 2 times through the bus stop chicane. And then Hugo Lewis will hopefully get the win here at the second time we visit this track in the season. 10th round of the season, 6 more to come, and a very important 50 points would that be.
And let's not forget, Hootie will continue to never have won at this racetrack in World Championship Series competition. So once again, it goes wrong for Gregor Hootie. This is his bad track. It's a track that he's never been able to be victorious at. Meanwhile, Stephen Michaels been able to get himself past Marcus Caton. He won't be able to close up on Andre Borcher before the end of this race. Borcher has fallen all the way now down into the 17th position on the racetrack. Riccardo Taulo actually has been able to move himself up into the 11th position. And we talked about this earlier. Some big attrition here today, Marius. But Bootsloop and Taulo, what a great drive by both of them. The amount of positions they've gained.
Yeah, and I believe you are going to ask me of the driver of the day but again. And Bootsloop came from 29th all the way into 6th. And put that against the race win from Hugo Lewis as well as 2nd from Gregor Hootie. As well, Jake Sturgis in 5th position right now. He came from 13th on the grid. So much people making up positions. In fact, only the top 4 roughly will finish where they started. I mean, take a look at that.
And of course, Alatalo, he's had a very tough week and not had much time to test that car, but he's running now in the 11th position on the racetrack. Meanwhile, Hugo Lloris coming through the bus stop chicane, this time by. The white flag is going to be in hand. There'll be one more lap to go in the 10th round of the Racing.com World Championship Grand Prix Series. We're going to go on board with Lloris for this lap. First of all, he'll come down. That's the slowest corner on the racetrack. Now onto the gas. He still has that issues, actually, that he's had all the way through that race, actually just being a little bit loose. Meanwhile, he'll now come through Eau Rouge. That left flick, that right flick, now a left flick into Radio as well. Now he'll come down the Kemmel straightaway. And Marius, at this point in the race, Luis can just cruise it home for here. It's been a sterling drive once again for the Brazilian.
Absolutely. We don't want to talk about a finished race that hasn't really finished yet. So we're going to enjoy this last lap, the last couple of times Hugo will go through these turns. Last time into Revage, then comes Pouhon, Fanier, and then all the way up into Blanchimont. And the last turn, the prestigious bus stop chicane. So half a lap done for the Brazilian already. 5.5 seconds, definitely enough for him to just cruise home to the victory here. And yeah, we may not forget this has been a great season for Hugo Lewis in terms of results, but then again, with two DNFs here, he's just lost that 100 points count to Gregor Hutu, and that is where the 89 points will come down to, and it will be 89 points between him and Gregor Hutu, and 89 points down still, we may not forget, that is a whole lot. So he needs to be strong, he needs to stay strong, but he's definitely made the first right move into the first move into the right direction, in fact, with the second win in a row here at Spa-Francorchamps, coming down Blanchimont for the last time, approaching the bus stop chicane, and it will be the Brazilian driver from My380 Gaming, Hugo Lewis, taking home the victory after 44 laps here at Circuit Spa-Francorchamps, 1 hour 20 on the clock, and there's the checkered flag. Hugo Lewis takes home the race victory.
So once again, Hugo Lewis makes it back-to-back victories in the iRacing.com World Championship Grand Prix Series. His last lap, we don't need to worry about that. That was a 149.619. Gregor Hutu, 3.7 seconds back at the end. Very quickly, Jeremy Buteloup on the last lap of the race is closing down Jake Sturgios. Sturgios might be a little bit light on gas. Can Buteloup make that pass into the last corner? He's going to slot it down the inside. If he can just keep it on the brakes, yes, he will. Jeremy Buteloup will tip the top five. He gets a little bit of a tap actually there on the exit of the corner from Jake Sturgios. Sturgios falls down into the sixth position, but Jeremy Buteloup, a top five finish for him. And what a way to cap off his race. To run through your top 10 then, it is Hugo Lewis taking victory from Gregor Hutu by 3.7 seconds. Luke McLean in third, 9.7 seconds back. Fulvio Barrosini in fourth, Jeremy Buteloup in fifth, Jake Sturgios in sixth, Ati Kirchhoff in the seventh position, Iker Hapala in eighth, Petru Kotavara in ninth, and Matias Egar rounds out your top 10. Just to let all the fans know, we always ask why the drivers come onto pit road at the end of the race. Mandated by the iRacing officials, just in case guys are pretty much scored at the very end of the lead lap and they have to do one more circuit. They don't want guys stopped on the racetrack. At this track, however, they only need to go as far as Lacombe and then they can pull their car off. And Hugo Lewis, what a great drive by him. He had to work for this win, Marius, and he did it in absolute style. He didn't, you know, put a foot wrong the entire race, sat behind Hutu, kept the pressure on, and then that lap before pit stops, what a great overtaking maneuver on the outside of the Fungus chicane.
And, well, I'll stop you right there. Don't ask me about the drive off the race, because I'll just go ahead and do that. With the pass in the last turn, I'm going to go and say Jeremy Buteloup, because he just started all the way down in the grid, way outside of the top 20, finishing not only that fire up, but also making that move in the last turn. Yeah, if one guy in this grid has deserved this award from us, I think this time it is Jeremy Buteloup.
Rob Koss is saying Jeremy Buteloup as well. I'm going to go with Buteloup. Yoni, you're going with Petru Kotavara, however.
Yep, just because of the fact that he was... We actually managed to catch a few of his passes, overtakings, and at the later stage of Lacombe, where he pushed his car to the inside after the pass overtaking already happening in front of him, and like outside of that, I mean, he started like what, 29th or 30th or something, and P9 in the end, top 10 finish, starting near the back of the pack. That's enough to drive the race for me, but. We have to remember that there was insane amount of good drives. Hugo Lewis passing Gregor Hutu in the Fanger chicane, and there was Ilkka Hapala making several successful passes in this race. Stefan Michaels climbing towards the top of the end. Several good runs, but my vote goes to Kotavara.
So. Going to continue with rounding up the coverage here from the 10th round of the iRacing.com World Championship Grand Prix Series. I'm going to show you a short video. This is called The Excitement of iRacing. We're going to be right back.
time for those most famous words in motorsports. Travis, start your engines!
Welcome back to the Glacier TV post-race show from the 10th round of the iRacing.com World Championship Grand Prix Series at Circuit de Spa-Francorchamps. To run through your top five, once again, Hugo Lloris in a time of just over 1 hour 20 minutes, taking victory from Gregor Hutu by just under 4 seconds on the racetrack. Nibba Klein in third, Fulvio Barrazzini in fourth, and our driver of the day, Jeremy Bootsloop, on the last corner of the last lap of the race. He needs to get past Jake Sturgios to get himself a top five finish. Jeremy, congratulations. Yeah. From 29th all the way to 5th. What a drive.
Well, thank you. Hello, everybody, first. Well, I'm kind of surprised by this, honestly. I thought I would crash really quickly, but in the end, I had some luck to avoid all the crashes and, yeah, found myself pretty quickly near top 10 and in top 10 and finishing 5th, overtaking Jake at the very end of the last lap, so... Yeah, really, I couldn't expect more, honestly, so I'm really happy.
So, you're qualifying itself, let's say, you started down in the 29th position. What happened? Was anything particular that went wrong in your qualifying laps to put you that far down the field? Because normally, we see you knocking on the door of the top 10.
Well, no, I just missed my first lap, but I kept going, you know, because I thought I had to have a lap recorded, and then I went for the second lap and I spun stupidly, so yeah, it was just mistakes by me. I'm not really comfortable with the car hot lapping, so I think it's a proof of that.
And the first part of the race itself, pretty crazy, a number of points off the racetrack, first of all into La Source, and then also down into La Coombe, and finally into the bus stop chicane. A lot of traffic for you to avoid. But how difficult was it actually to work your way through that?
Super, super hard. Especially I think it was at the end of lap one or two. Last chicane, someone spun and I saw Paul was also spinning. So I tried to avoid him and I saw X4 on my screen. I was, oh man, I hope I don't have any damages from that. And well, in the end, the car was clean, so I was able to keep going and go fast, but yeah, I had some crazy moments at the beginning of that race.
And then getting yourself up into the fifth position on the last corner of the last lap, seems like that Jake Sturgios wasn't very happy with that pass.
Well, no, honestly, I understand him, because if I were him, maybe I would have been really frustrated. And honestly, I thought he would defend his position in last turn, but he left the inside open and I went there. I tried to brake cleanly but as late as possible, and I did it, and then I tried not to allow him to overtake me again, and it worked, so it was great moment.
Well done, top 5 finish, our drive of the day here from Spa, Jeremy Bootsloop, 5th place finish. Petri Quartararo, how you doing, buddy?
Hey, thanks, I'm doing good. Very good.
You're actually the youngest driver of the day. You came home in, the 8th position on the racetrack after starting the race down in 25th. In fact, he came home ninth. My scoring is messed up. Came home in the ninth position in that number 17 Azura car. But again, it's been a tough race for you as well all day.
Yeah, after I managed the first two laps, I saw myself like 15th position already, and then it was all about getting those guys in front of me, but I did three times cut the Air de Rouge, so I got black flag and had to slow down. So without that and without other mistakes, and maybe if I got past Pablo quicker than I did, I would have been fighting with the top 5, but I just gotta accept this result because I got into home very last minute for the qualifying and did the first laps with qualifying setup. I only did some practice with the race setup, so wasn't very comfortable with the qualifying setup, but I'm good that it's not all about the qualifying.
Well, anyway, Petri, apologies for what happened there. But good race for you. You looking forward to Indy in 2 weeks' time?
No, actually, I will be missing it because I will be away from home. So after that, I'll try to race as much as possible for the last remaining tracks, which are like Suzuka, Montreal, and that will be very nice.
Well, well done anyway on a top 10 finish in this race. Let's Petri across the bar. We're going to have a quick chat as well with my favourite Team Redline driver, Axel Kirchhoff. It's been a very long, tough day for you today.
Oh yeah, this was an eventful race, let's put it that way. I had more practice in the past, focusing on many things. At the same time, driving GT Academy, driving in R Factor for some personal reasons. And my real practice started yesterday, and I'm super happy that I really had good pace today. I was kind of worried about today in terms of my teammates. You know, they always are quick in practice, and my job was to keep up as good as possible. And I did, and actually on race day I destroyed my personal best lap times, and in qualification it didn't all come out. I did have a decent lap, but it could have been much quicker, of course, like everybody else. But I really have fun in the first part of the race. Luke was a little bit heavier than me, but he was defending really, really hard. So yeah, I lost contact with Hugo and Gregor, and I knew I was on their pace, so that was a little bit frustrating. And when I tried to pass Luke, we had contact. I watched it back, and it's hard to say what happened there, but it destroyed my front wing, which made racing really, really hard. I had super understeer, and I lost like 10 kilometers an hour on a straightaway. So I was going from 49s to 51s, losing 2 seconds a lap, and I didn't know what to do. I had the option of waiting until my tank was empty and do a quick last in. I didn't know if my front wing would have been repaired, but I got so frustrated. I was sweating out of anger, and I was like, okay, this is enough. I go into the pit, and I came out of the pit, and my car was so much better. So I think my virtual pit crew did a good job on the front wing and replaced it. So from there, it was instantly fun, and it instantly reminded me how much fun Spa-Francorchamps can be in iRacing. So from there, it was maximum attack. I was kind of angry seeing myself on P20, and I had to do a very long stint, and competing with guys who were who had more fresher tires. So I just pushed all as hard as I can, and I think I showed a pretty good pace. And once I could close the gap with Ilka and Jeremy, it was kind of a fun battle. I was hoping I could pass Ilkay a bit quicker to have a shot than passing Jake, Jeremy and Jake. That would have gained me two positions in the end, but the battle with Ilkay was kind of a bit messy. And although it was really fun, I really have fun every time when I fall back in the mid-pack and I see those guys fighting hard, and you just see how much fun racing can be instead of endless hot lapping sometimes in the top three just to keep up or managing the gap. This is kind of fun too. So I had a good day, and I did a good job on damage control, let's put it that way.
And of course, next time we're going to see you in the Arizona.com World Championship Grand Prix Series will be at Indianapolis in 2 weeks' time. Is that going to be a track you're looking forward to?
Absolutely not. I'm going to go on a mountain bike trip the week before the race, and I'll be returning a couple of hours before the race. So I need to do my practice in the first week if I can put any in. And it's going to be another race of damage control. Hugo won this race. He scored a whole lot of points. I failed to score good points today, so I think P2 in the championship is going to be harder and harder. So congratulations to Hugo, congratulations to Gregor. He had a bit of bad luck with running out of fuel in the pit lane, I heard, but P2 for him, and P3 for Lucas, a good result for the team.
Well, actually, we'll see you next time out at Indianapolis. Just before we go, we're going to have a quick chat with Fulvio Parazzini. And Fulvio, once again, it's been a good race for you in that Triple M car. I think Fulvio's not here.
He is.
He is, indeed. He just can't hear us so quickly. So we'll come back to Fulvio in a moment. But before we do that, what we'll do, we'll run through what's happening a little bit later on Glacier TV. We've got a IndyCar weekly special coming to you from Pocono for the Arizona.com Pocono 400. That will be at 5 p.m. GMT for IndyCar weekly before the race itself. That kicks off at 6 p.m. GMT. Live coverage throughout the 400-mile race. And if you saw the race yesterday, it was incredibly fun. I was in the top split myself. It was incredibly, incredibly difficult. Today, it'll be Young O versus Matt Cook versus Martin Miller. People like Ryan Norton in that as well, Randy Freeman, all looking to have a good race. So join us on that. Both races will be streamed live on YouTube. In the meantime, we think that we've now got Fulvio Barrazzini. Fulvio, hello. No, we haven't. Of course, the Arizona.com World Championship Grand Prix Series returns in 2 weeks' time. That will be from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway's road course. Of course, Indianapolis Motor Speedway steeped in history for the Indianapolis 500. In 2000, they added the road course, which allowed Grand Prix cars to race at the track for the first time. They raced there from 2000 all the way through to 2006. The MotoGP drivers, they still run on that track as well. One of, I believe it's three races of MotoGP drivers run for the time being. So we'll be on air with the F1 show once again from 2 p.m. So from 1 p.m. GMT, with the race itself starting at 2 p.m. GMT. That'll be live on Glacier TV with live timing and scoring, of course, available from our friends over at the ISOWC. Let's try it one more time. Hi, Fulvio Barrazzini, how you doing? We can just about hear Fulvio now. So, Fulvio, you've had yourself, once again, a pretty good race. At some point, it looks like we're going to fall back just a tiny bit, but you get yourself yet another top 10 finish. You've got to be happy with that result.
Well, definitely, for sure, I'm happy about it. But I felt I lost a bit of too much time in the early stages of the race. Unfortunately, and at the first turn, I actually went a little bit too wide, a little on the grass. Then when I rejoined the track, it just hit my rear left wheel. I had to brake hard not to spin, and that was terrible because I had an extremely good start. I would have been P4, I think, after the last tour. So a bit of a disappointment, but in the end, I'm definitely super happy about this P4.
They sent another top five, not top 10, top five finish for you in this race. And that really does make things interesting when you think about the championship, because you're now overtaking Martin Kroenke up to 180 points. You're not too far away from Jake Sturgis as well, only 47 points behind him with five rounds left to go. Is that your challenge now, trying to beat Sturgis in the championship?
Well, if I think about it, I have to bite my fingers, because in the first part of the season I had four races with a DNF or disconnection, and that's a bummer, because I was also always on the top 5 position or close. So if I think how many points I've lost, it's kind of a disappointment, but I think everybody has their issues. You know, for example, it's in this race or currently leading for the rest of the season. So definitely I'm not looking at the past, I don't complain. There's a lot of races left, and see how it goes.
Well, we'll see you out at Indianapolis in 2 weeks' time, Fulvio Barrazzini. And that, unfortunately, is all we have time for. So we'll see you in 2 weeks' time for the 11th round of the Arizona.com World Championship Grand Prix Series. Of course, we'll be back on air in an hour and 8 minutes for a special episode of IndyCar Weekly, building up to the pre-race show for the Arizona.com Pocono 400. So we'll see you all in just about an hour or so. Until then, bye!